We've got DJ Savi, 50 Shades of Grey, and the 8 types of men you'll find on dating apps today on It's Complicated.
Powered by Acast.
You're listening to It's Complicated with your hosts, Jennifer Golden and Lauren Leonelli, coming to you live from the AfterBuzz TV studios in Los Angeles, California.
Hey, everyone. Welcome back to another episode of It's Complicated.
The struggle's real when you're dating in the city.
I'm Lauren.
And I'm Jen. Oh. And today our drink of the day is a Moscow Mule because DJ Savi, our guest, loves this drink.
Yes.
And DJ gets what DJ wants, guys.
He sure
does.
I'm making it right here.
I mean, shout out to the bartender.
Vodka.
Coming my way.
Yeah. Okay, you guys.
Psyched.
Yeah. So today we have Jim Saviano, a.k.a. DJ Savi.
Savi.
Make sure you say it right. He is in the studio. We're so excited. He is one of the newest and upcoming artists currently touring electronic dance scene. And he's a DJ, like we said. And he broke out in, like, late 2015. So, like we said, he's very, very up and coming. You might know him. He was featured alongside Bebe Rexha and on Havana Brown's Top 40 hit Battle Cry, which... I know. Good song.
Great song.
He also released his first solo single, Breathe It In, or Drink It In, whichever one you prefer, but we like to say Breathe It In. And there is, you know, like 4 million streams of the song so far, so it's obviously doing well, and he's got, like, a really great sound. His stuff has gone viral. He's in, like, the viral 50 of the top 10 and 100 dance tracks on iTunes. There's been, like, early support from really huge DJs like Tiesto, Artie. I don't know how to say Tritonal. Is that the one? Because I'm
sure.
Not totally familiar with that person. But
sounds like
Morgan
an adjective.
Page, Blaster Jacks, like a lot of people are talking about DJ Savi, and we're talking about him today too.
We sure are. And as Breathe It In continues to build traction, Savi also just released a major collab on November 25th with Armada Music and Nervo. You guys, Nervo's a big deal.
Yeah.
And Lauren Bennett. And after only 4 days that it had been, you know, released, it was added to full rotation on BPM and iHeartRadio. So that's a big deal because you just never know, like, how far a song's gonna go.
You never know. So just getting it out there is the first step in the game. And he also played his first music festival in September in San Diego. Kaboo.
Sounds snazzy.
It's a new music festival,
Kaboo.
I guess. And
I feel like music festivals, by the way, just put a lot of vowels in the word.
Totally.
Like Lollapalooza, it's like all the vowels.
And like Bonnaroo.
Right.
It's like,
what
is
that?
I don't know what you're talking about.
There must be like a method. Like, you know how there's like a generator for stripper names?
Yes.
It's probably like
it's
that.
It's like that. There's like a algorithm for like consonants versus the number of vowels or something. I don't even know. Anyway, but he's also played like the big clubs. Like he's, you know, been on the marquee at Dre's in Vegas, at Omnia in San Diego, and even 11 in Miami. And again, has played next to some of the top DJs like Calvin Harris, Steve Aoki, Tiesto again, Cascade, Avicii, Nervo,
jeez,
Alesso. I mean, Afrojack, just to name a few. Like, really, this guy is blowing up.
And the crazy thing is, I actually know him from like years ago. So
yeah.
To hear
what a shock.
Surprise. Jen for president.
Here's your Moscow Mule.
Oh, well, thank you, my dear.
I don't know how strong it is.
It doesn't even matter.
But like all that.
I'll take
vodka,
it. Oh, so, well, sassy for 10 a.m. in the morning. So I've known him for years. So to hear that he's doing so great is phenomenal.
That's
and
nice.
Great to have him on the show. So glad that he's coming in. He actually got his start interning for Carson Daly.
Oh, yeah.
Who's one of my favorite hosts on TV other than us.
Oh, wait, hold on.
Thank you.
You need a line.
Dash me, please.
Yeah.
He was a co-host on the Hot Hits Live from L.A. alongside Andrew G. and is also an actor who's appeared on Touch on Fox, Entourage, guys, that show, Punked, and Greek. He currently lives in L.A. He's our neighbor. And we're going to talk with him about what his big plans are for 2017, what songs are coming out, what tours he's got going, and what it's like to be with the DJ.
Yeah.
Because, you know, people are groupies, and maybe we'll be some of them.
And maybe we will be. Cheers.
Cheers.
Oh, my God, it's so full.
So full.
Help.
Okay, well, we'll take care of that.
Oh, wow. Yes. Okay, guys.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
All right. But first, before we get into some celeb news and DJ Savi, we are going to fill you in on what we've been up to this past week when we air our dirty laundry. So it is a very small world in LA. Once you've been here long enough, you realize that that is just the case. Like, everyone knows everyone. Like, you know DJ Savi through this person and that person. And anyway, so I have a couple of different mutual connections to my boyfriend. So it always makes you think, like, how you met somebody or if you would have met, like, in another way because of so many different connections. So we have a connection through a friend I know on my own right that he dated in college. We actually went to her Christmas party. She's married now with her husband. She's having a big birthday soon and we're going. And it's just like, it's just crazy how, you know, that all happens. And then we went to a baby shower this past weekend for a girl that is best friends with a girl I used to nanny with. The girl that I used to nanny with is married to my boyfriend's fraternity brother.
What?
So they went to college together, and we all know this family, this couple that are married with three kids. My boyfriend's daughter is like friends with their daughter that I used to hold when she was first born because I knew the mother before she was even pregnant. We worked together.
Wait, I have a quick question about this, all of this familiarity. Now, does that make him feel more familiar because you know the same people, like, versus
kind of
like a stranger? Like, he's got all these like kind of, like, not
it's like mutual connections and stuff. Yeah, it does a little bit, but yeah, yes, I guess in a way it does. It's hard to really say if it's just because he's also so warm and welcoming too, but yeah, it does also feel like kind of like we're cut from the same cloth, but not really. Like, so yeah, that does. Anyway, so
I think that's what a lot of people are missing from the dating apps, because it's a perfect stranger.
Yeah.
And I feel like you're almost more apt to date someone you have like a mutual friend with.
Sure.
Just because it's like you feel almost more connected to them.
Mm-hmm. And we met through a mutual friend. So my friend that I've been friends with for like years and years and years met him more recently. And then we met through him, so that he was the catalyst. So it was sort of just kind of like, there's a lot of different mutual connections. So yeah, maybe subconsciously that is like a thing. I don't know. I mean, it can't be a bad thing. So
no.
Anyway, and then on Saturday, later on Saturday, we had everyone over his house for like the football game. And like, it was nice to have Jen was there because my boyfriend's daughter is in love with Jen.
Like, yes, I sat there through, I went to the hair salon.
Yeah, you went to the hair salon.
The pretend hair salon where they did my makeup, my hair, my nails. Also,
uh-huh. And a massage.
And, well, I asked them, I was like, guys, you know, if you really want to make this a legitimate hair salon, you should probably incorporate massages because that's what they do. So the little 7-year-old girls were massaging my hands. I was like, well, I'm going to benefit from this game too.
Of course. So that was a very smart turn of events.
Thank you.
That. And it was fun because I've got a lot of girlfriends that are married with kids, and you don't lose touch. You just sort of like, they're the type of friends where I could go months without talking to them. Not that I do, and it wouldn't really matter.
Those are the best kind of friends.
Yeah, because nobody's taking offense. Like, you haven't called me. Like, who fucking cares, dude? Like,
right,
we're
life
friends.
Happens.
Also, we're friends. Like,
right.
There's nothing that you need to worry about. Like, you have kids and a husband and a house and the things, and I'm still going out and getting drunk with my girlfriends, and, like, that's not your life. So nice. But anyway, it was nice to incorporate them into it because they brought all their kids over, and they were playing with my boyfriend's daughter, and then it was singles too. We stayed up really late playing cornhole and drinking. I drank beer all night and was really hungover the next day, and I don't know why.
A chihuahua.
And I'm really excited for girls' night tonight.
That is exciting. Mm-hmm. I am too. I, like I mentioned last week, am in the process of adopting a little pup.
She's a mom.
I think she's got a name.
Morgan Freeman?
No.
But why not, though?
Well, and I had promised that I would reveal, I think, her name this week. Maybe.
Oh, you did?
I think last week I said that she'll have a name by next week.
Because you wanted help, too.
Right. I needed help. So
what did you pick?
I even created, like, a Google form, and
Jesus
I sent
Christ.
It out to people.
Oh, yeah, she did do that.
And I wanted people to vote and cast their, like, maybe suggestions. You made an interesting choice.
Fizgig.
Yeah, that was a name I had never heard of. I actually saw that.
It's from Dark Crystal.
And I was like, did she really write that? Maybe it was someone else.
No, it was me.
Yeah, it was you. So I actually had to read our outline to know it was you. To put it together.
Right. Got it.
So anywho, I think her name's going to be Mochi because she came from Asia and she's a cute little pup, and I call her a monkey, so I feel like it won't confuse her that much if her name is Mochi.
Yeah. That's
cute. She's a real cute baby. She got spayed this week. So I actually spent a lot of last weekend and this week with her, caring for her. I actually had a third date with somebody. He came over and made me dinner and like played with the pup, and it was really cute to see how he like took to the animal and how she took to him.
And this is the same guy from last week.
Yes.
Okay, we
and
like,
so he's really great guy.
Great.
We'll see how that goes. I'm like kind of like positive about it because you know, normally I'm not, and I get like the heebie-jeebies from people and like ugh.
But that's okay. Even if there's a moment where you get the heebie-jeebies, it's okay. It's just like a process of getting used to it. The heebie-jeebies can happen, but if they like are lasting a long time. You might have a moment where you're like, okay, I need,
Well, this one doesn't give me the heebie-jeebies. He's actually great. He's got like a great balance of all the things that I like in someone. So we'll just see. I'm sort of more focused on my animal than anything else right now. And I'm being a good mom. And like, she threw up yesterday and I was like, ugh, everything's going to shit. I can't talk to anyone today.
Yeah.
Focusing on animal. So
I get it.
Like, he's just sort of there. And he's like, that's, he understands. And he's like, well, we'll hang out this weekend. I'm like, great. See you then. Like, I'm busy with the animal.
I like it. Talk to you when I talk to you. I like
that you're busy. Me too. And
gosh, speaking of busy.
Yeah.
We've got some celeb news. We're going to pack up our emotional baggage and we're going to meet our favorite celebrities in baggage claim because Amanda Seyfried has been pretty busy and under the radar, there's announcements and weddings and babies. Oh my.
All at once.
Never been more excited because in her Vogue Australia interview in the February issue, she is going to have a baby. She announced she's going to have a baby. She's about to get married. She said she's never been more excited. And, you know, she's really like not doing the traditional wedding thing. She doesn't want a white dress. She said she's dressed up so many times on the red carpet and all the attention's been on her. Like, she doesn't want it to be like that. Totally agree with her. I do want a white dress because, like, I don't wear white. I'm sure she's worn a million white dresses
right
before.
In movies, especially. She's played brides and things,
and she's gotten married a million times, she said, but all the attention on me and all that, like, shit, no thank you. Like,
no, I think it should be like a joint experience.
I hate when people say like it's the bride's day. It's like, it's not though, because there's also another person getting married to you and all of your guests are there, and it's everyone's day.
The bride's day is on her birthday, Mother's Day, just those days, really. Only
it's just
those
too
days.
Much pressure. So I agree with her. Anyway, good for her. Congratulations.
Congratulations. And apparently, by the way, they got engaged like 2 months ago.
Oh, yeah. Well, would make sense because now she's announcing the pregnancy.
Right. So that means she's been pregnant for 3 months because you announced it at 3 months. So they got engaged 1 month into pregnancy. I did the math. So maybe I'm not saying that they got engaged because they're pregnant, but I think it's a good impetus.
Sure.
Sure.
Nice word.
Thank you. It's my $5 word for the day.
Great.
So Jamie Dornan wants to make one thing clear. He is not Christian Grey. I mean, he wouldn't even be friends with Christian Grey.
He said he wouldn't even sit next to him in a pub.
No. And like, he seems like a cool dude. Like, not Christian Grey. No,
Jamie Dornan.
Not at all. Jamie Dornan.
He's fucking hot, but he actually kind of, to me, I don't know, he doesn't seem like a cool dude, or maybe I'm just only going on every time he talks about this movie that's making him a shit ton of money. He sounds a little ungrateful. He's like, this is kind of a shitty movie. This guy's kind of an idiot. Like, I guess it's going to make money, but it's kind of dumb. It's kind of lame. It's like, dude, stop like killing everyone. Stop taking the sheen off of it. Like, you're an actor. You're playing somebody that you're not going to be friends with.
Yeah.
It's not you. Calm down.
But he also does say like that he totally gets people that are haters because he's like, it's not for everyone. But he totally is like, 100 million copies sold. There's obviously going to be butts in the seat. So in the seats of the movie. So he's like, listen, I know that I'm going to get paid. And I know there's an audience for this, and that's what it is. And he's an actor. He takes a job. So I'm not mad at him for it.
And he also is very openly saying, like, it's not my bag to be, like, S&M, but, like, I don't, you know, fault other people or judge other people if that's their thing.
I kind of like that he says that.
Yeah.
Because, like, it's so hard for people often to separate actors from their roles.
Yeah.
Like, people, like, stop people in the street, and they're like, oh, my God, Christian Grey. He's like, I'm probably just Jamie Dornan.
Yeah.
He's got a wife. He's got kids, the whole thing.
He's so hot.
So hot. I can't handle it. It's that, like, serious look that's, like, questionable. You're like, what's going on behind those eyes?
I never saw the first one.
Oh, you got to see it. It's just trashy and amazing. It's like watching The Bachelor.
I like trash.
Anywho, so speaking of trash, you might find some on these dating apps because there are 8 types of guys that you'll cross when you're on the dating apps. Now, there's always going to be the great one that like catches your attention, but then there's these other guys. So there's probably 9. There's the one that gets through the fucking ruckus, and then there's the guy who openly wants one thing because he's not shy about it. He's just, you guys match, you text, and then he's like, so I'm out with some friends, you want to hook up?
Yeah, all of a sudden it just comes out of nowhere.
Gross.
Or there's the guy who tries to pretend he doesn't want only one thing, and then all of a sudden he's like, so do you want to hook? Like, he'll have that banter with you, and then all of a sudden he'll just say, you want to hook up sometime?
And you're like thrown for a loop because you spent all this time talking to this guy, and you're like,
no,
I thought it was going in a certain direction, and all of a sudden, no, his true colors come out.
Like, we haven't even met yet, and you're just asking me, why don't you meet me and try and like woo me?
Right. I mean, you know, take someone on a couple of dates. Mm-mm. let's just see what happens there. Mm-hmm. Then there's the guy who's just too keen. Mm-hmm. And he's, like, super into you. And then, like, continues to ask you for plans. But it's, like, almost right away. And you're kind of, yeah. like, you wonder if there's, like, a sense of desperation there.
Totally.
Or if they're just really excited because they've been through the rigmarole that yeah. you've been through. And they're just, like, finally a normal person. I want to see you tonight.
Yeah.
But and also, then, people are busy.
And it's, like, message after message after Ugh. Message with no response.
Yeah, get a hint.
What about the guy who changes his mind? That's fucking annoying. Like, they're talking with you. You're making plans. Like, where'd you come from? Do you like this bar? I like this bar. Ooh, how about we go here? And then all of a sudden, there's like no nothing.
Radio silence.
Rude.
So fucking rude. Been there, done that, though.
Yeah.
Then there's the guy who can't take the hint.
Ooh, that's the worst.
It's kind of like the guy who's too keen, and if you don't keep responding, and then he keeps writing you, like, hello?
Yeah.
Obviously, it's not going to happen. I mean, I've experienced 100 of those. Sorry, guys. It's not that I've changed my mind, too, but, like, yeah. Or the guy that can't take the hint. It's yeah. all the things combined,
yeah,
really.
It is. And then, you guys, there's the bencher. Now, we talked about this with the This Is Why You're Single girls, mm-hmm. and this is a real thing. It's the guy that messages you like every few months. It's also called like a breadcrumber. It's like someone who sprinkles and then like periodically messages you, but like so few and far in between that they're not really trying to make an effort, but they don't want to let you go. It's like they're keeping you on the bench. That
so
is
annoying.
And like really honestly, like I think the first couple times it happens to you, you're like, that's weird. And then after like the second or third time, you're like, motherfucker, bye.
Yeah. Boy, bye. Then there's the guy who keeps chatting but never makes a move. Okay, no one wants a pen pal.
Oh, it's the worst. That's the worst offense out of all
no,
of these.
No, because it's like, A, you're a stranger, and B, we're already having to do small talk, and that's like insignificant. And then C, you check in with me and ask me how my day is, but like, do you want to see me and talk in person?
Wasting
or you really
time.
Care about how my day is?
Wasting time.
So much time wasted.
And then there's last but not least, and this is like probably a little bit more like rare, but
it's a little Christian Grey if we're gonna call it what it is.
Someone on this panel could relate. It's the unabashed fetishist.
That's a word.
So this is just someone who straight out is like, I like S&M and chains and whips and barking like a dog or whatever. And
I'm not vanilla.
And
some might write in their profile, and then some other people might go out with them, and then some other people might receive texts that say, I'm into BDSM, so if you're not into it.
I appreciate your honesty, but listen, it happens.
Right. Totes.
All right, guys, so before we get ready to have DJ Savi in the studio, we just want to play one of his songs for our song of the day. It's Battle Cry featuring Bebe Rexha and DJ Savi. It's Havana Brown's Battle Cry. We like this song because it's like about strong women. It's an anthem. It's like you drop your insecurities at the door and you drop the beat with DJ Savi. And you know what? It's like kind of like a kiss-off song. So play it while you're working out, getting ready for a night out, or just play it out. It's a good one. Download it. Take a listen with us for a second. Yeah. I'm a lone ranger. I'm a smoke you out. It's good. It's good.
I mean, I'm like really having fun over here. I don't know if it's the alcohol, the song's on, and DJ Savi's in the house.
That's right. Hello.
What up?
Morning.
We have a ginger beer for you, sir.
Oh, wow. You really got all the way up here.
You even got a Tito's cup.
I think I've slept about 4 hours total in the last 48 hours.
Okay, good. Then this should Sweet. Help.
This is exactly what I need.
Okay. All right.
I'll present it to you.
Okay,
go grab
here.
It.
You stay there.
Wait, I'm liming.
Oh, lime it.
Sorry. Sassy. I'm trying here. I'm trying.
You're good.
I made it to your perfection. My hands are clean. Or are they?
It's fine. He's left 4 hours. He's good. He won't know the difference.
All right. Welcome. Okay. So where have you been that you've only slept 4 hours in the last 48 hours?
Yeah. What
are
you
doing? Tell us about your.
I did. It's been the last couple of weeks. It's been pretty crazy. But I was in Miami. Then I did 4 nights in Vegas. And then I'm trying to finish this next single. So it's been a lot of late just studio hours.
Jeez.
Yeah, I wish I could tell you some crazy party story, but it's really just been work.
But that's okay.
That's actually better. We appreciate
feel like that's
that.
Better.
Cheers, by the way.
Yes, cheers. Cheers to 10:30 in the morning vodka.
Yeah, why not?
I mean, you know.
When else would you have it, really?
I mean, I hope it's good.
Kathy Lee and Hoda drink at like 7
oh, yeah.
in the morning, so.
Nailed it.
Yeah? Good. You know what? We gave you this beer, but there's also this one. So
this
if you
is
want
an open
more,
bar.
No, that's a good one.
Okay, good. I don't know what I'm doing, but you know anyway. Okay, well,
Happy New Year,
yeah,
by the
Happy
way.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year to you as well.
All right.
Saw you at the end of last year.
Yeah, finally.
I know. It's been like years. So we know each other. We already discussed this on the show. And I was trying to think of like how we knew each other, but like through like our friends.
Through friends. We go way back to your earlier party days.
Oh, like when I first moved to LA.
Both of your earlier party days.
But look how far we've come. We're actually working professionals now.
Trying, right?
Yeah.
Oh, I think you're both doing pretty well.
I'll
piggyback on that.
Yeah, and here you are,
I'm
too.
I'm here, too. Hi. Welcome to the studio, Lauren.
Lauren.
I'm here.
All right. I mean, I know how you, like, started in music, but you got to tell everyone how you got into music. Because, like, people move to L.A. They've got big dreams.
There's always a story, too. Like, we started out somewhere and ended up here. And, like, it's not always a clear path.
No.
You end up somewhere that ends up feeling right. So where did you start? Like, how did this all begin?
I moved to California from Chicago.
Okay.
And I was managing a nightclub at the time called Hyde Lounge.
The first Hyde Lounge.
Where Golden and I go way back to.
Yeah. Yeah. Good times.
Oh, God.
And
I remember
our resident DJs were DJ AM and Steve Aoki and Sam Ronson. And in working my 80-hour slave work to the venue, I also had been in bands and play instruments my whole life. And you could just start DJing on a laptop. So I was like, I could do that. So I started as a hobby. On my birthday of May 2007, I bought turntables.
What?
And my first gig
and
was
a microphone?
Actually, two turntables and a microphone. You're quick.
I got it too. I said it. I was like, oh, okay,
My friend Brett Gursky, who is also our mutual friend.
Shout out to Brett.
Was doing these dinner parties at the time that Dustin Hoffman's son Jake was the DJ at and had booked a film. And he needed someone last minute and asked me if I could do it. And I had never even DJed before. But I knew how to play music. And that night it was like,
you got thrown to the wolves.
Paris Hilton, Lindsay Lohan. Like all these girls,
were
right?
Were you scared?
I was nervous for sure. But it went really well. And that basically catapulted the start of what became this career.
So you felt like you were kind of like pushed into, you were kind of prepared and you have a background in music. Wait, what instruments do you play, by the way?
Drums and the guitar.
Okay. Sweet. So you can keep a beat, clearly. And that's good. And so then you probably felt like you had this background, but like actually getting up there and doing it is a different story. So once you did it and were good at it, you probably felt like, all right, this
is the
right
path.
Well,
I don't know if I was good at it, but I did know how to play good music. And
I feel like that's half the battle. You have to have good taste.
Yeah, that's true.
Because like if you put on shit, and then there's like dead air and like people don't know how to like mix the music right and then people look at you.
Yeah,
and
but
like,
I mean like the mixing in the dead air is a technicality, but at least if the songs are good, people will forget about it. You know what I
right.
mean?
Right. You do have good taste in music.
8 years ago, here we are.
Here we are.
That was 8 years ago?
Yeah. It's been a hell of a journey and still growing. So it's actually the most exciting time I've ever had right now because I started putting out music last year and that's really changed everything for me.
Yeah. Okay, so you mean putting out music like you're producing songs and...
Yes.
So
producing and
work?
Writing songs.
Okay, so you produce and write. Now, when you produce, like, let's say you were part of Battle Cry that we just played.
I was.
What are the, like, steps in that?
Yeah.
Did somebody already, like, write the lyrics, and then you're like, here's the beat?
Every song's different. Some songs, you will go into a writing session with, you know, a couple songwriters or a songwriter, and we will literally sit down to either guitar or piano and write a song.
Okay.
Others, you get a vocal. You know, it just depends.
Okay.
That specific song, Bebe Rexha had co-written with this guy, Jonathan Keys, and I think there was one other person. And the vocal came to me by way of my publisher. And I worked on it for a while, just trying to figure out, like, how to make it modern, because I think it had been written several years earlier. I kind of was just sitting around. But when I heard it right away, I was drawn to it. And I met this guy named Billy Van, and him and I had had a very clear cut idea that worked, and we pitched it to Havana Brown, who was a really close friend of mine for like several years back when I used to do a radio show in Australia, and she was into it. And then I don't even know how the magic happened, because it was different publishers, different labels, it was a massive headache, and somehow it all came together, and Havana put it out I think late 2015.
Mm-hmm.
And it went top 40 in Australia. But at the same time, Bebe Rexha had gotten Hey Mama, and that went, I think, like number 2 in the world.
Okay.
And so Warner Brothers put all their attention into that record.
Nice.
And it was Havana's first time in the pop genre, and for whatever reason, it just didn't cross over into the rest of the world. But
okay.
It did pretty well in Australia.
Yeah.
And it's really fun, and the video is really fun. And I think you make a cameo in that video.
Right in the beginning.
Yeah. Right?
Wait, where? Are you one of the dead guys or something?
No, I was.
I think he lives.
The cowboy in the beginning that gives her a little head nod.
Shit.
By the way, it was meant to be like, if you've seen my other videos, I don't like it to be at all like focused on me. It's always on someone else or the song. And then, you know, you make a tiny little cameo.
Yeah, how odd, considering you are also an actor. So you wouldn't want to be a bigger role in the videos that you're in?
It depends, you know. I haven't found anything that makes sense. I don't want to do the cheesy thing. Like, it's not like, hey, look at me. It's to me, you know, the music's really important. I'm really selective about the kind of songs that I've been putting out. My first single, Breathe It In, like, I came up with the concept with Hannah, who's in the video, and I produced that, and I edited the majority of that project, you know. This music video we just did with Nervo, we had this idea for the mannequin concept before it was the mannequin challenge.
Uh-huh.
And so, obviously,
there's something creepy about mannequins.
Dude, it was awesome to film, and it's super eerie, right?
Yeah, uh-huh.
There is.
But that was a concept being used in film and television at the time, but it had not crossed over into music. So we were ahead when we had the idea, and then...
But everything's a process.
Race Rummer took it to another level.
Well, it's you know, it's kind of like dating. Like, when you were talking about your battle cry and the process, like, that song had been written, like, years before it even, you know, actually came to be. It's almost like when you know somebody... Like, I know people who, like, had been friends for a while, and then all of a sudden, one day, they, like, start dating. It's like, how do you do that? Like, and then things just start making sense. Like you said, you met with a writer, and, like, all of a sudden, there's no explanation as to why it works. It just does.
Timing.
It's like...
Timing.
Do you think that when it comes to, like, obviously, professionally and musically, like, timing, even just writing the music has a lot to do with it, or just making a project come to be, timing has a lot to do with it. But in the dating world, do you believe that, like, timing is everything? Some people don't think it is.
Like it says right here, it's complicated.
Sure is.
It is, but
it is very complicated.
Yeah.
You know, I think that as you go through different stages in your life, you will interact even in the way that you watch a movie from 20 years ago, because your life is so different now, it means something completely different
to you.
Totally.
That's a good way to say it. Yeah.
You know what I mean? You're not watching the movie, connecting to the movie as much as you're connecting what they're telling you to your own life, and then you're relating in whatever you're going through.
It's like a whole different story.
Same thing with songwriting, you know? Some of the songs that are coming out, not just for me, but artists in general, they've had for years, or at least a year or two, you know? And sometimes it takes a year or more to even break a record. It just depends on... the circumstances surrounding it.
Right.
And some of the music that I've put out have had for 2 years, and then also one of my records that's coming out in a few months, we just wrote like a few months ago. So
can you tell us about that song?
Yeah.
Yes.
Tell us about it. What's it called?
Oh man. The song is called Mom, I Made It.
What? Look, is it because you made it?
Look, Mom, I Made It.
It's a song that was literally about the journey of following your dream and then achieving that dream. And the girl that I wrote the song with is this 18-year-old girl.
Wow.
Who moved here with her family. Her whole family moved here for her music. And so when she was telling
me... How supportive.
Like Taylor Swift.
Yeah.
Damn.
Her mom's actually, I think, the trainer for the Kardashians right now, too.
Oh, shit.
But her family had moved here literally for her music. She is really young. And when she told me the concept, I've had this concept I wanted to do called Mom, I Made It for a really long time. I just didn't know if it would be like a movie or what. And from her talking to me...
Oh, God, so it was so broad.
It was
really just like Mom, I Made It.
Like a
super
concept.
Broad.
You didn't know if it was going to be a song or a movie or what? Oh, wow.
Clear as day what I wanted to write about. And there was another writer in the room with us. And they were both kind of like, yeah, I don't know. And I was like, no. And, you know, it's really hard sometimes. When I was younger, I wouldn't maybe not have had... the persistence to say, let's stay in this lane and try this. And
sure.
It did. And it was all for the best because we wrote a massive hit. And I have a huge name that's going to come on the record. I just can't say who it is.
Oh, my God.
But I'm really, really stoked. And that's going to be, I think, like probably at least 3 or 4 more releases from now. So there's several more records I'm putting out before we even get there.
Okay. So is this like your 2017 resolution to just like pump music out?
Mm-hmm. Pump it out.
Well, I spent...
Pop up the jam. Mm-hmm.
I broke up...
Had to.
I broke up with my girlfriend last... Or we broke up last January. And I spent the first 6 months of 2016 living, like, in a studio, making music completely isolated from the world.
Do you think that having a girlfriend made it hard to focus, or are you able to compartmentalize?
Both, you know? I mean, some of the stuff I was writing about came through the experiences from that relationship. And then I think once I got a lot of that out of me, you know, you work on different, like, different songs that the stuff I've been writing now is not really relationship based at all, because I think I've discussed that and I'm not there. It's more about more passionate stuff, mm-hmm. and just maybe some life issues that are going on.
Sure.
But when you spend, you know, I travel every weekend, so you like literally live in an isolated room, pretty much the size of this room. And the only person you talk to are the people you're writing music with, right? Mm-hmm. So when you get out, it's, you know, I remember going to dinner with my friend Katie, and it's like the first time I'd sat down with somebody in almost half of a year. And I almost like broke down crying because I had so much I needed to talk about, but I was not wanting to get it out. I wanted to get it out in my work.
Save
you know?
It, yeah.
I wear my heart on my sleeve, and I think it's really important that as an artist that there's a message and not just like, oh man, I need to figure out what to write about so people like my music.
Sure.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. And I think that comes across in why certain songs resonate with lots of people, because you feel the emotion.
Yes.
And people can relate. It, like, if you're just going to write a song about, like, I'm sorry, the cherry lip gloss, what is that Katy Perry song?
I have no relation to that. Well, that's fine, whatever. But, but like, you know who did that for me? Who
that's
started?
I Kissed a Girl, I think.
Yeah,
that's...
like, I don't relate to that song. Did
I
just
kissed
write
a girl
it
and
funny?
I liked it.
Like, I mean, maybe.
But I relate to that song.
She was trying to just, like, you know, push some buttons or whatever, I think. But I feel like the lyrics in a song are really important. I call myself a lyric Nazi. Like,
she
need to know what you're saying. I want to hear the story you're telling. I will Google the words before I can say. I have to know what you're saying. So I totally get that, like, getting the story and coming from, like, a real place, it just somehow translates. I feel like you can tell the difference. Like, for me, I really used to love when they first came out, Maroon 5. Like, sorry if anyone's friends with them or whatever. But, like, their music was really good on their first album, and now their music, it's like they fucking gave up on their lyrics.
And they just
they're
are like, oh, I saw a zebra today.
So sweet.
Their new song's kind of dope. I don't know about
what,
that.
Which one? Song?
The Don't Wanna Know song? That's not them. That's just Adam, right? No. I like that song.
I don't like any of it. I feel it's a second grader wrote, like, I'm here today. Want to go play? What do you say?
Hey,
there, just wrote a fucking Maroon 5 song.
Done.
Everyone, it's like they gave fucking up on their story. So I think stories are important.
In terms of what you're saying, the really difficult part with songwriting in general, when you are an artist that's been through you know, the transition of several years, it is A, where you are as an artist, because you might get tired of something that you were doing and want to change it up.
Sure.
Also, the people you're working with, if you change the songwriters that you write songs with, or also music evolves, right? And so you try and adapt to where music is.
There's,
you know, it's a combination of a lot of things, and not everything's always a home run.
That's true. And it's also very, like, a subjective thing too, because I a lot of people love their stuff. I don't like it anymore. I feel like it's just they gave up.
I'm committed. It's like a really long-term relationship. So I just love them in theory, and I'm going to love them forever, even if their songs are animals, malls, malls.
I feel you there.
I'm going to love it so hard.
Oh, I love Justin Timberlake so hard, no matter what he does.
I would like to equate lyrics in a song to relationships.
Go
and
ahead.
I'll tell you how this works out.
Okay.
And now it makes more sense why we have Lauren's lyrics as part of the show.
Yeah.
So how you said you fall in love with a song based on the lyrics.
Yeah.
It's like you almost have to know someone really well to then fall in love with them. Like, you have to know their story to fall in love, just like you have to know the song story to fall in love with a song.
That's
well,
true.
Well, if you listen to radio, you'll notice that the volume on the vocals are always really high and the music is really low. Radio is set to compress the music down and the vocals to be loud, because they want you to connect with what is being sung and sang, which is why the melody is super important a lot of times, more often than even what the message is in commercial radio, unfortunately. But true.
I think that also the melody helps you remember the words, I think.
Yeah.
Or for me,
it's
it
like
does.
A trick.
Well, actually, if you recognize when you go to karaoke nights, people don't even know the words half the time, but they know the melody, right? And
oh,
so that's why the melody is so important.
I can't stand when people don't know the words. I will stop you and be like, that's not the words.
Yeah, she does it to me all the time.
I'm with you there.
Fuck, it bugs me so bad.
But what if you want to know the words, but you just can't remember them?
Well, then don't sing them and look it up and memorize it and then sing it.
Okay.
What? Do you sing karaoke?
Baby Got Back.
What? guess we'll have to go out for a karaoke sometime.
Yes, we'll have to, because also, have you ever seen me shoop? Probably not. And maybe you should.
So.
Because it's pretty epic.
It's pretty great.
I'm into it.
And I give a mean Bohemian Rhapsody.
You do?
I just want you to know.
I also just killed Four Non-Blondes.
Listen, you killed it. We need to go out.
Now you're talking about, like, one of the hardest songs to sing. You must have a really high register.
Oh, no, I don't think I do. I just commit. I don't care what I sound like. That's the beauty of karaoke. It's like, you don't. I'm not up there trying to be fucking discovered. I'm not, like, plugging my ear and singing.
I am
just like, also, I work the room, too.
What's your go-to karaoke spot?
Oh, I really like the Belmont.
Belmont's good. I've done a couple songs there.
Well, because I don't want to drive to Koreatown.
Oh, Korean town?
Koreatown?
Yeah, Koreatown.
My dog's Korean. I say what I want.
Have you ever been to the parlor?
Yeah. Your bar?
I do. Oh, yeah, yeah, that's right. Yeah.
How did that happen?
Little plug?
Yeah,
wait, hold on. And that makes sense with your Australian connection. What the fuck is up with that bar and the Australians?
Yeah.
Why?
They're so cute.
Explain.
Wait, what do you mean? Which bar?
The parlor.
They hang out there.
They, meaning the Australians.
Oh, there's a lot of Australians at the parlor.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know that it has anything to do with me. However, that's great to know.
No, it doesn't have. I'm just saying, though, uh-huh. But you have a connection to Australia.
Yeah.
You did Australian radio.
So
I hosted a radio show called The Hot Hits Live from LA with Andrew G, who's basically the Australian Ryan Seacrest. He hosted The Australian Idol. And,
well, now
he did
I feel
Australian
nervous
Bachelor,
like you're judging
you know.
My radio.
Are we
podcasting?
No, you guys are you're fantastic. I'm fighting a cold and underslept, so I'm trying to keep my energy up.
Maybe
for you
need more alcohol.
I got it right here, and I'm definitely drinking it.
Okay, good.
Good, because like I'm almost out.
We have
out,
more
so.
If you want. Oh, okay. Yeah.
But it was a show that I don't even remember how I got connected to, but they wanted a DJ that was in the LA nightlife scene to come and talk about LA because it was really a transplant of Hollywood into Australia, right from the heart of Los Angeles. And at the time, I was playing every major club in LA every night of the week. I literally lived in nightclubs.
Jeez.
So there was a lot to talk about. But it was a really cool experience, and I did it for a couple of years.
You were there for a couple of years?
I did the show for a couple of years, yeah.
But like here from here, but remotely.
Yeah, always
got
from
it.
LA.
Okay, got it.
Did you have to record at weird hours because the time difference?
We recorded...
Or was it not live?
We recorded, like, I think at 7 o'clock at night or something like that. And it aired live, but I think it might have been live to tape. I don't remember.
Okay.
Interesting.
Either way, though, it was an awesome experience, and I got to meet a lot of cool people. Havana Brown being the biggest relationship that I met from the day that I met her. I was like, dude, I need to work with you.
Yeah.
She came in with We Run the Night before it even broke in Australia, and that day I said, this is a major hit. Can I remix it? And it was the first remix that I ever did.
Cheers to that.
Yeah.
And that was well before Red One got involved, and they made it with Pitbull, and then it became like...
Right.
Mr. 305?
It went number one, you know, Mr. 305.
Oh my God, that's
you can take
her favorite.
A girl out of Miami, but you cannot take... But
that was... That, there you go.
Jeez. I mean, you guys.
Okay, wait. Speaking of remixes. So now, listen, if I wrote a song, I'd be like, why are you remixing it? Wasn't it good before? But like, you remix it, and then it's like, even better.
Sometimes yes, sometimes no.
And you've worked with like everyone. You've remixed like a bunch of big people. Like
I've worked with some people.
Okay, I'm just gonna pull one out. Enrique Iglesias again.
Oh my god.
Miami.
Oh my god.
Here's where things come full circle. When I moved here to act, the first job I got that got me into SAG was being Enrique Iglesias stand-in.
What? No way. You are a million times taller than him. How'd you do that?
No, I think I'm like an inch taller than him. He's,
oh, really?
He's like 6'1", I think.
Oh, really?
That makes you 6'2".
It was a Dave LaChapelle music video.
Oh, I love
Tommy
his
Hilfiger.
Stuff.
And, you know, I met Enrique. It was a very quick head nod, and that was it. But it was funny because I don't actually think I really look like him at all. But I had his profile, apparently. And then fast forward several years later.
And you could be his hero.
No, he's definitely my hero.
But that was amazing, and that is one of my favorite songs.
Maybe he seems shorter because he's always like in a shower, water is falling on him, so maybe he
and
just
like
makes
he's
him
just,
feel.
His posture is shorter.
He's
like,
just shorter. He's
because
smaller.
He's always emotional, so he's got to like cower, like maybe like hold himself and
I
rock.
Feel like you're bigger than him, just saying. It's fine. Anyway, we'll let that one
that
slide.
That was a tangent.
It was good.
I'll take it.
Okay, but also.
The Pentatonix, love them.
Yeah, so that was actually the biggest frustrating moment I had of 2016.
Why?
Because we did that remix, and it was the most epic thing I think that not only have I ever done, I've ever heard. Because it's so unique, right? I mean, there's not any EDM DJ that's even touched a Christmas song like this. And we made Little Drummer Boy, like the Christmas classic, okay? From an a cappella group and turned it into
I know
EDM
I know it.
Me too. Yeah. I just got chills.
I love the Pentatonix. My friend actually hosted a show that like brought them to
They're
light.
Sick.
So I also have known of them for a while because of him. And they're fucking amazing. All of their voices are like stellar, yeah. And then together it's like
it's insane.
Holy shit.
That whole a cappella thing to me is like magic.
And I'm gonna say this. I love Christmas. Little Drummer Boy, let me finish though. I'm gonna let you finish like Kanye.
I'm gonna let you finish.
But like, I fucking hate that song
yeah.
until your version.
Yes.
I hand to God, like, love. I heard it recently this year, and I was like, oh my God, I love this song now.
Well, because the song ultimately is pretty creepy.
It's very dumb.
And also, drummer boy.
And the drop we made very, to match, eerie, but yet had a lot of soul.
Yeah, and also, yeah, it does. And also, like, when has anyone ever been like, drum roll, please? And people go, pum 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 pum. Nobody, it's
no,
like,
no, it's, you go,
like, no, that's not how like fucking drum sounds. That's
not
how a drum sounds.
It sounds like a drum roll.
Yeah, no. So, also, and then, yeah, it's, anyway.
That song is great.
Thank you. And so great that I was so frustrated because we made it, like, probably 2 months before Christmas.
It's a lot of pressure.
At the same time that, this is why timing sometimes sucks, they had Hallelujah that came out and went number one.
I love that song.
And so, again, another Warner Brothers thing where they did not want to push anything away from the attention on Little Drummer Boy, and they, a week or so before Christmas, were like, okay, we're ready to proceed. And I was like, great. We got, like, what, 7 days to get people to listen to the record?
Yeah.
And right after we put it out, I got an email, and it was like, yeah, you know what? Let's just wait until next Christmas. To what? To do what?
To what?
The sound changes. It's not going to be the same.
Exactly.
However, I think it's so unique. Maybe it'll work, but you can expect that to be re-released with a full release next year.
And also, Christmas songs do have, like, an everlasting quality to
that
them.
Is true.
So at least then you have that going. It's a classic. Everyone knows it. Everyone knows the words.
Like,
so
it's not going to go out of style.
It's not going to, I think you've got a little more, like, shelf life with it because it's a Christmas song. And it's
actually
fucking
more
them.
Than anything else, really.
I think so.
Okay. I love Christmas so much. Oh, wait. Okay. So, yeah. I think I know where you're going. Sorry, I cut you off. I just want to ask. So.
You guys are finishing each other's thoughts.
I don't know, actually, if you know.
Well, I was going to say, so you're a DJ, and you said you travel all the time, and you're in and out of town doing these shows.
Yes.
You go to Vegas, you go to Miami, you do all these things. Does that make it hard to date?
Yeah.
Yes. Had that conversation.
Are you currently single?
I am single right now.
Oh, this is so good.
Yeah. Was that where you were going?
Yeah, it was.
Cool. See? That's how we do.
I'm wearing sunglasses, by the way, to hide the lack of sleep on my face right now. Not because I'm an asshole.
Or that.
Larry David says there's two people that wear sunglasses at night, blind people and assholes. I'm neither.
Yeah. I mean, I was going to say douchebags, but no.
I was going to say DJ, because I feel like you have like a look when you're a DJ. I don't know. Maybe that's your DJ look.
I don't know. They're reflective. At least we can see what he's seeing.
At some point, we're going to have to ring out the Snapchat in this room. I could already tell.
What? Yeah.
Oh, okay. God, I'm not good at that game, but you guys
actually,
can do
why
it.
Are we not Facebook Live-ing this?
I don't know.
Do it right now.
There's so much to do at one time.
It's a lot, but you know what? We're of that age that we can do multitask. Are we millennials? I'm not a millennial. I'm too old
you
to be
are.
A millennial. I
you
am?
Are.
Am I really?
Yes, by math, you are.
No, I'm not,
yes,
though.
Yes, 80. Sorry.
Really?
Yeah.
It's fine. I don't care how old I am. Hi.
Hi.
I mean, I don't care if people know how old I am.
Say hi to my 24,500 followers.
Hi
guys. Follow us on Complicated Show, everyone.
Yeah.
If you want to see this whole interview.
Yeah.
You're gonna hear some good things. We're about to start talking about the real stuff.
Yeah. Dating and shit.
So you're single.
Let's talk about it.
You're single and you go on the road and you are out of town all the time. How the hell do you date? Or do you date in different cities? What do you do?
What do you do? You use your DJ booth as like a dating app? It's like the ultimate dating app.
Lure.
Are you on dating apps?
I think being single in general is shady as shit.
Why? What do you mean? Why?
Do tell.
It's a different world, you know? Everything's ran by social media, right? So
okay.
There's, you know, you used to have to go out to meet people, and now you can literally open up an app and swipe right and then start talking to someone you don't know.
Sure. Okay?
You could actually never leave the studio if you wanted and meet all the people.
Genuinely. Although that's not at all how I would ever live. I did sign up for Bumble, I think shortly after I ended my relationship earlier last year, and I've never been on a dating app date ever.
Oh.
So I like pride myself on that, and if I do ever go on
you
one,
pride yourself
it would
on that.
Have to be really special.
Oh.
Yeah, because dude, I mean, I went on one blind date in my life a long time ago, and it just was not, you know, sometimes you get somewhere and you're like not feeling it. You don't want to be there, but at the same time, you don't want to be rude. So you go through the motions.
Yeah.
I don't want to go through the motions.
I get it.
I'm at a point in my life where I would rather spend quality time with someone that I'm genuinely interested in or just not be out with someone at all.
So weird, because this one sitting next to me has said the same exact thing. I agree, but you have legit said the same exact thing.
I have. Hi.
But it's true.
It is true. It is very, very true, and I agree, but how do you meet people? You, personally.
You know, the problem is that I'm in a club a lot, right? So you meet a lot of people in nightclubs.
Up into club.
And it is very, very unreasonable to think that you're going to turn around in a club and there's going to be someone there that's going to be like your dream girl. Although I can tell you, I did meet someone in a club like several months ago, and we had a connection, and we talk, and we're friends. And, you know, you never know what can develop. But I have a lot of friends like all over the country, and there's, you know, different people that I talk to. And I'm not at all trying to pursue a very serious relationship yet, because I just got out of one like a year ago, and I think I'm at a point where I am starting to want to date again. But I'm taking my time, and also this is the most complicated time in my career, and I don't want anything to distract from what's really, really important. At the end of the day, like, I want to be a dad. I want to have a family. My brother and sister are both married with kids. And it's, you know, I think from seeing my nieces, my goddaughter is like, you have to go on my Instagram and see her, because you will be addicted. Everyone I know is addicted. She's such a special person. All my nieces are, but
this one's your goddaughter.
Because she's the first, and she's my goddaughter, and she also like looks like she could literally be my daughter.
Aww.
It is like a very, very special connection, and it's definitely, you know, ignited that flame of wanting to be a dad, which is why I'm working so hard, because I know that I'm going to have that opportunity. It's just that this time right now is for the work, so that then later I can focus on the family.
And you want to make sure you're in the right place too. How long were you with the girl before that you broke up with a year ago?
We dated for about a little over 2 years, maybe 2.5 years.
See, that's why we haven't seen each other in so long.
I travel every weekend.
That's true.
Maybe also you don't go to the nightclubs anymore.
Oh, no, I don't.
And where
I don't
are you?
DJ in LA that much anymore.
You don't. If you do, where are you?
Well, I'm going to be playing at the new Marquee Tao Group operations. They're opening the Dream Hotel.
Opening a Dream Hotel here?
It opened last night. There's a ribbon cutting.
Sweet. Where is it?
It's Selma and Coenga across from Kitchen 24.
Shut the front door.
So that's great. That's
where
right
the
there.
Old AV used to be. They took that whole space over.
And I want to go.
There's a Tao. There's a Dream Hotel. There's Avenue, which is their club from New York. Beauty in Essex. And then the Rooftop Lounge.
Well, that is a lot of clubs.
It's a very, very serious hospitality.
Really program. Like, oh my God.
But I'm going to break my retirement in LA to play that venue, literally, because their family have been playing at Marquee in Vegas for about 3 years.
Yeah, great. What a great connection. When are you doing that?
Probably we'll wait until the day club opens, so spring, summer-ish.
Oh.
But I might make a little guest appearance.
You're going to make us wait?
I know, really. Jeez. How can other people outside of LA see you? Where can they go watch you DJ?
All over the country.
What?
hit up my website, Savi Music. My calendar is pretty up to date, although actually I need to update it.
Okay. Update that shit.
But I'm in Miami every month. I'm in San Diego every other month. I'm in Austin every like 6 weeks. I'm in Vegas like 6 times a month. So that's the biggest place that you could always see me.
Yeah.
Which everybody's in Vegas at some point.
Sure.
Yeah.
And I'm playing festivals this year. My first one is in March in Cabo with Galantis and Dioro.
There's a festival in Cabo?
First one, yeah.
What?
It's called Cabo Music Festival.
Oh, is it like Cabo? Because there's always a lot of vowels.
Cabo during spring break. You already know.
Dude. Chihuahua.
Oh my God. That sounds like a fucking hangover central.
And like a lot of groupies for you. Like young groupies.
And a lot of like wet t-shirts and boobs and stuff.
Yeah, yeah. Brace yourself.
I've done Cancun spring break several times. I've done Cabo spring break a couple times. And it is by far the biggest shit show.
Are you like immune to shit like that now? You see like a chick with like tits everywhere and you're like, oh.
Tits everywhere. They're just everywhere.
And you're just like, oh, there's another one. Like you don't, it's like being in LA and being around
could
celebrities.
Could not be more immune to it than I currently am.
Really? Like, no, I'm like, you're like, after like 10 years in LA, you're like, oh, Robert De Niro is sitting next to me. Oh, fuck.
Oh God, that guy. I will say this as a single person.
Jaded as fuck.
Yeah, really. Oh, Robert De Niro,
jaded
that guy.
AF. Oh, that fucking guy?
Yeah.
Ugh.
So as a single person, like, okay, obviously if I'm on dating apps, like it says people's professions and it says like where they're from and it may be like a little blurb about them. If somebody wrote that they were DJ, I would just assume that dude is going to be like a cheater because they're going to have girls around them all the time. Like,
Jen.
Well, I'm just saying, I'm not saying you are. I know you, but like,
you wouldn't go there straight.
No, but we're on high alert for all the community of females are on high alert for like red flags because we don't know someone, so they might be a stranger.
You would be more red flagged that person's a slashy. Do you know what slashy means? We're
going to
tell you. A slashy is like I'm a DJ slash bartender slash model
slash Uber driver.
You just coined a phrase. I've never heard that before.
Yeah.
Sick.
I would think your first like red flag would be this fucking guy's a slashy.
Sure. But then I would also like, I have a friend whose boyfriend is a DJ and he's gotten around the country for reals. But like,
man,
how do you dispel that stereotype?
But I mean, he just said he's not really looking for a relationship right now.
Totally. But that doesn't also mean he's
in
like,
the back of my mind, I am. So if you meet someone, you're always thinking
about it. Of course.
And
you never know.
It's not the priority that it was once a few years ago when I was like, when I hit 30, 31 is when I like, you know, men mature much later.
Yeah.
I like,
oh, was, we know.
Yeah, yeah, sure.
It's complicated.
Especially in LA, I'm sure you definitely know.
Yeah.
But I really made it a point to stop all the dating, which is like, if I met a person, I'd be like, let's go to dinner. I didn't really want to waste time at dinners with people I didn't know anymore, because for the most part, it would really just be like a social thing and end up being nothing else.
Sure.
So I prefer to develop friendships with people.
Oh.
I think that the most beneficial way to have a successful relationship is to build a friendship first, because if you don't even like the person, eventually that's going to come out, right?
Sure.
So you may as well look at trying to develop a rapport with them that is way beyond anything you're going to get from just like dating someone.
Sure.
You know, my brother and sister, I think, both married their best friends. Aww. And my sister married like my brother's best friend. And
that's pretty much the cutest thing
I've
ever heard.
And my brother's wife is also my sister's friend. So it's like really crazy how it worked out.
So now you just need your person to fit right in with that, like,
you know, I really want to have a friendship before anything. I think that's really, really important. Because
do you guys have each other's numbers?
You do.
Yeah, come on.
What? I can't, you know. I mean,
JG in the building.
You guys have known each other for a really long time. I do this to her all the time. I'm at the grocery store, and like some guy will be sitting next to me, like, my friend is single.
$2.
Here's her picture.
Are you married or you're single?
I have a boyfriend.
I like that there was nothing in between, married or single.
No. So, I mean, I'm not married, no.
I mean, the way I look at it is, even if you're not actually married, if you're in a relationship, you're kind of married, right?
Oh, well, yeah, I mean, sure.
It depends on who you ask, actually. If you ask a guy, it might be a different situation.
Yeah. No, totally. I think you're, I mean, yeah, I don't, it's a level of commitment. I don't really think the paper means shit.
Here's the problem with dating that I really, drives me nuts. The me agenda, right? Everybody is on the me plan. And when you're in LA, the real problem is that it's the bigger, better deal, right? Like, someone meets someone, they're thinking really into it, but it's, I'm only into you kind of. I'm also talking to other people because maybe someone better is going to come along.
Like a venture.
That shit never existed to me until I moved here. And really, it didn't exist to me until I got into the like nightlife scene.
Right.
I think it's an industry thing in general, because I do notice it in other markets. But that's not how it is in the Midwest. It's totally different. And I really miss that grounded style of like getting to know people, you know?
Which is probably why you don't bother to do something unless you're feeling like really serious about it.
Now I do, yeah. When I was younger, though, I also, you know, you become
a maturity
victim.
Thing too.
Yeah,
right, 100%.
Yeah, for sure.
And I like I always say about the dating apps, like, it's great if you don't have an opportunity to meet people in person. Like, I work with you. There's no one else here, so I'm not going to meet somebody through work necessarily unless they're a guest on our show. But that's why I'm on the apps, because I'm not going out anymore like we used to.
Yeah, it's another avenue.
I think everybody gets on the app, even when they're in relationships, because, hey, maybe I might, you know, someone might pair with me that could potentially be. That's the problem.
Oh, right. That's shady.
People just want to upgrade because they're not sure. No one wants to settle anymore. We don't have to settle anymore. It's not like you met someone that's great, so you're going to make that one thing work. But now you've got so many options. You can just
do have so many options.
Try it out.
I do not watch and have not ever watched The Bachelor, okay? But I watched what was his name? The guy from last season that everybody loves.
Oh, Ben?
Ben, right? I watched the Ben Higgins season, and it blew my mind. I was like, this guy had to have been coached the fuck up.
Oh, yeah. They
because
all
he was so almost perfect in every situation, right? But it really made me, like, realize communication, on top of my own experiences, is so important. And he was so communicative with each individual situation and girl. And it blew my mind because it's like, brilliant. That's exactly the way to serial date, right?
Sure.
And that's kind of
because then you can be like, what I told you.
Right. Well, girls like to like not hear things. So they'll be like, well, he said that he's that and he's not looking to settle down. But I think he's going to fall in love with me because
They think that like, yeah.
Right.
Well, it's also because it's true. Like, you can say what you want to say. Like, I'm not looking for something serious or I want it, whatever. But at the end of the day, your feelings are your feelings. So even if you're like, I'm not looking to settle down, if that fucking person walks into your life, you're
lights
like,
out.
Yeah.
Done.
What are your,
and then you write a song about it.
What are your feelings about when you are dating? Is it okay to go on dates with multiple people and try and get to know them, or are you supposed to just date the one person that you're getting
to know? I have a question about what you mean by the word. What is dating? I've had a conversation with my boyfriend about this. What the fuck does dating mean to you? Like, the definition. Yeah. What is dating? I'm dating this girl. What does that mean to you?
Going to dinner with someone is not dating. Hanging out with them a few times is not dating. seeing regularly, okay, where you're like, you're regularly start seeing someone, you're dating someone. It does not mean you're in a relationship. There's no commitment on either end.
Okay, you're in the gray area then.
But you are in the gray area because no one person has sat down and said, hey, look, I really like you and I only want to see you.
So
and until that happens, I don't see why you're supposed to not get to know other people.
I agree with that too, actually, because of also age. So now if I were in my like 20s, let's say, I might give somebody, you know, all the chances in the world until it fizzles out, sure, or maybe it keeps going. Now I'm like, shit, I can't throw all my eggs in one basket. I'm in my 30s. Yes.
Also, it's not even that. It's also like, I'm not going on date number three with you if I don't like you. Even if it's only just at the level of date number three, if I don't see you as somebody that I could be with from whatever you're showing me, there's no glass ball. I can't predict the future. But if I don't like, there's something I don't like about you or I'm not feeling it, I'm not going on. It's not going to take me fucking 6 months to figure out if I like you.
Right.
I can tell pretty much, and sometimes you're wrong, but I can tell after a couple of dates. Like, I don't need to go out with you again. Like, I'm not into it.
But I think you can multitask.
But, like, I think dating is the same as you. Like, if you've gone on, like, two or three dates, I wouldn't say I'm dating someone. I would say we went on some dates. If we're seeing each other more regularly, I'm dating you, but we're not, that's not
exclusive.
My boyfriend. Dating doesn't mean boyfriend.
Right.
My boyfriend thinks dating means, like, I'm dating only you. I'm like, oh, well, too bad, because I was dating
him. I mean, it's like a verb. I mean, hello. He just needs
to
listen to our show.
He was the same way. He just saw it differently. So there was, you know, a little bit of like a
But at the same time, people assume, and they just find themselves being maybe caught off guard because they didn't ask. If you asked and you're honest with someone, which is the key, you know, I will tell you, like, I'm talking to other people.
Yeah.
And it's because I'm not looking to just get into a relationship. I'm looking for either a life partner, or there's no reason why I should be in a very serious relationship.
Unless that's what you're ready for, that's what you want, and that's something you can't help or be ready for or say, like, it's going to happen at this point in time. It just happens.
Well, that's why it's magical, and it's love, and it's what people write songs about.
Yes,
that's right.
They do.
And then they drop the and then they drop the beat to it.
Mic drop.
Okay, so where are you next on tour?
Where am I next on tour?
Oh, God, I took
the last 10 days of this month off to finish my next single. It's called Coming Home.
Mm.
And I thought I finished it yesterday, and then I decided to start it all over again.
Oh, okay.
Hey.
Are you a perfectionist?
Yes.
Okay.
Which is why if you listen to most of my music, you know, I can't even say this, actually. I think when you finish something that's art, you can go back to it and go, oh, God, why did I do that?
You're never really done, probably.
You're never done. That's a problem with music. That's a problem with pretty much any art in general, is it's ever-changing.
Sure.
So you just have to try and make the best that you can. And
then remix it.
And you can, but that's what's great.
Remix your own song.
You can revisit stuff or remaster, right?
Yeah.
But the problem is that you're never, ever going to be truly happy with it. So you just put it out and you do the best that you can and you move on.
You gotta let it go at some point.
The other problem is that it's also a business. And so sometimes in this instance, I am trying to get this out right away. And because of the pressure, it's like, I wanted to just go with the one I did because it's done and I could put it out in a few weeks on one of the labels I'm signed to. But instead, the mature part of me and the one that's had experience doing this is like, no, you're not fully happy, and this is a really, really good song. Let's try and get it right.
Yeah.
So I decided to start it all over again, which could be, I can knock it out in a few days, or it could take us, like, I don't even know, months or years before we get to where we want to go.
But you got to listen to your instinct on that one.
But I really believe in doing justice to when, you know, it's really hard to get a very, very good song, and I don't want to ruin it. I want it to be the best it possibly can be.
I like it.
That's a good motto for life.
But in terms of touring, I'm in Miami at the top of the month. And then Vegas again at...
and maybe a surprise in L.A.
L.A.'s for sure going to happen. I just don't know what date it's going to be yet.
Okay, well, you've got to keep your people posted on all of your platforms. So tell people where they can find you again one more time.
Instagram, DJ Savi. Twitter, DJ Savi. My Snapchat is DJ Savi. And then everything else is Savi Music.
Okay.
Sweet. So, guys, follow him. Go see him. Listen for his music.
Are we done? This, like, flew by.
I know, right?
Didn't
it's
we
so
say
fun.
It would be fun?
I mean,
you guys
hello.
Are awesome, though. Thank
Thanks.
You very much for
having
me.
Oh, my God.
Me.
Thank you for coming in. And you guys, don't forget to tune in next week. We've got Bron.
I don't know
Houston
how to say it.
Stam. That's how you say it.
Good job.
He's a professional surfer, and now he does some other things. So don't forget to tune into it. At Complicated Show on all the social medias.
Mm-hmm. And we deliver this content to you guys free every week. And we know that you've got like a zillion podcasts to listen to.
A scrillion.
But you come back to ours and we couldn't be more thankful.
That's
what you could actually do for us maybe is tell a friend.
Please do. And, you know, don't forget to subscribe to our podcast on iTunes and Acast. And you can catch up on all the episodes, past, present, and future. And
you can re-listen to this one if you want to.
You can too, and you
like
should.
100 times.
You should. And also, shout out to Justin
Mateen the Dream.
Yeah, for 5 stars and an awesome review. Thanks, Justin. That was really sweet what you said, and we love you so much.
All right. So, guys, you can find me at Jennifer Golden. That's Jennifer with one N, one F.
Don't with the
Golden.
F.
Fucking
there's
learn how to spell
two
it.
Two Fs.
You
ever.
Know what? Some people don't know how to spell, and
Jennifer?
They just they're idiots.
No.
I don't know. I love you though. If you're watching, whoever you are. Thanks for tuning in. Yeah, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, my website, Snapchat,
yes.
Google.
And you can find me at Lauren Leonelli on all of the things. I know. I was like, I don't know what I'm saying. At Twitter, Facebook, and my website. All right, guys. Thanks again. Thanks, DJ Savi.
We will see you
next week. And
love you
long time. Cheers.
Oh, yay.
Oops, it's water.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.